Hi everybody, my name is Zach Peterson. I'm a technical consultant with Altium and I want to thank you for checking out this video. So today and in some upcoming videos, we're going to be talking about mixed signal PCB design and layout and also routing and everything else that goes into mixed signal design. A lot of PCBs are mixed signal boards and they take some careful layout practices to make sure that you don't have interference between different types of signals. Now, one thing that happens in a lot of mixed signal boards is some designers will implement some not so great grounding and routing practices. And a lot of these practices stem from some design guidelines that date back to like the 1970s and 80s. And the problem is that back in those days when a lot of chips were running a lot slower, frequencies were a lot lower, you could implement not the best grounding practices and the design would probably work fine. Today, most chips are in fact high-speed chips and need to have much more careful grounding practices implemented in the board. So let's get into it and we'll see how we can implement some best practices with mixed signal design and layout. One of the things that happens in mixed signal design is first, you need to think about how signals travel on your traces. And this relates back to some fundamental theory on transmission line. And we'll do some more videos on this coming up. We'll also link some stuff in the description so you can check it out on Altium's website. To get into mixed signal routing, we need to understand what happens on the PCB. So generally, when you have your PCB substrate, and then you have a trace above it. Here on the trace, you have a signal that's traveling, and the signal has some electric field that it emits, and that electric field terminates back to the nearest ground plane. So if you have a ground plane below your trace, what happens is the electric field will terminate down here in the ground plane. And if you've looked at some mixed signal design guidelines online, or you've looked at some high speed design guidelines online, you've probably seen a picture kind of like this. In this picture, essentially what this is showing you is here we have the electric field due to charge that is traveling on this trace. And the electric field is what carries energy between components. This ground plane then experiences a current. And we call this current a displacement current. This displacement current arises due to the electric field drawing in some current through the ground plane. So this displacement current is essentially what happens in capacitors. So if you go back to your electronics 101 classes, you'll remember when I power up one side of the capacitor, it induces a current in the other side of the capacitor. Well, if you think about it, in this arrangement where I have a trace routing over a ground plane, I have basically just created a little tiny capacitor. And there's some current here that flows in the ground plane that charges up this capacitor. So this is really the fundamental thing to remember before you start working with mixed signal design, because it relates to something called the return path. And this is really what determines whether different types of signals will overlap and interfere with each other when you're routing around the PCB. And so this is one of the reasons that actually you'll see people implement really bad grounding practices in mixed signal PCBs. Either they don't really understand what the return path is, or maybe they get that there is a return path, but they're not quite sure how it's tracked. And so they implement some bad grounding practices to try and isolate signals in the board. So we're looking at this from a side view for now. But let's look at it from an overhead view just for the moment. Let's say I've got a component right here and I've got a trace that I want to route to another component. And just for simplicity, I'll just put a 45 degree angle in here. And I've got another component over here and I want to route this trace between these components. What happens is here my signal starts traveling in this direction. And as my signal starts traveling, it induces a displacement current in the nearest ground plane. So let's just assume for a moment that there's a ground plane below this first layer. Well, what happens is the return path wants to induce directly below the trace. It's not exactly directly below the trace. What really happens is there's some current that's spread out a little bit below the trace. That spread out current, it follows roughly a Gaussian type distribution. Now, as the signal travels along this trace, it continuously induces this displacement current in the nearest ground plane. This is generally what happens with a digital signal. And when you have a digital signal, it's actually really easy. Modern digital signals running at, you know, on the order of nanoseconds rise times. If we have nanoseconds rise times, this displacement current tends to get induced in the ground plane pretty close to this trace. What happens though if we have, let's say, instead of a nanosecond rise time digital signal, we have an analog signal? Well, this is where we have to look at the frequency. So with digital signals, the power spectrum spans from essentially DC all the way up to very high frequencies and theoretically out to infinity. With an analog signal, that's not the case. If you look at the power spectrum, it's ideally focused on one single frequency component. And theoretically, it's an infinite amount of power in a zero bandwidth frequency. So what that means is that instead of spreading out like this nice kind of Gaussian distribution, what happens is the return path in your board could possibly be spread out something like this. So let's say I'm sending my signal this way down the trace. The return path could actually span this whole region in a very broad area around the trace. This is actually one of the reasons that with very low frequency systems, you want to try and separate your components as much as possible so that way you don't have too much interference between different circuit blocks. Here, where this return path spreads out below the trace, if I were to say have a digital IC right here, it's sending signals to another IC right here, there's actually now the potential for crosstalk between these two because they're too close to each other. So here I've got my digital signal. It's inducing its current below it in the ground plane. And there's the possibility that this analog signal creates a little bit of noise in the digital signal and vice versa. If you spread these things out and you route them in different directions and you're very careful with applying some isolation, like maybe some V-offenses or something like this, then you're able to separate out these signals a little bit. And the whole goal in mixed signal design and layout and routing is to try and isolate these different signals from each other so that they don't interfere. So this isn't the cleanest drawing, but it kind of illustrates how you want to think about where your signals are propagating. The forward signal that's coming from your IC is traveling along the trace, but in reality, the electric field around that trace is what determines whether or not these two groups of signals are going to be interfering. So in this with my analog, and this with my digital, I want to try and think about where the return current is located in the ground plane beneath these beneath this surface layer for my components. And that's what's going to determine whether or not I can properly isolate my components and make sure that my signals don't interfere. This whole thing that I've been talking about with this messy drawing, the main takeaway for mixed signal designers is this. The goal in mixed signal design to ensure signal integrity is to separate your analog and your digital sections. Keeping the uniform ground plane ensures that you always have a nice clean return path. But you still need to separate the analog and digital return paths in order to make sure that your different signal types don't interfere. Generally, you want to make sure that your digital signals are not inducing noise in your analog signals. It's less bad if your analog signals are inducing noise in your digital signals because your digital receiver essentially runs in saturation and it has some immunity to noise. Analog signals where you're doing something like having to read out an analog signal with an ADC is actually much more sensitive to noise. So you need to make sure that you don't cross those different types of signals and allow them to interfere. Doing that is all about separating return paths. There's actually a really interesting paper by Bruce Archambault. I'm probably mispronouncing his last name, so Bruce, if you're watching this, I'm sorry, but your paper is very interesting. This paper was published in IEEE EMC Society, and in this paper, Bruce actually simulated the return current path for different frequencies, and it's actually really interesting to see how the return current spreads out below a trace at lower frequencies. So this is really important for mixed signal design, and what you find is that at higher frequencies, that return current stays closer to the trace. That actually makes it easier to deal with in mixed signal design. So we'll get into more in this in the next video. Just remember, in mixed signal design, track your return current paths, keep a ground plane, and you'll do a lot better than folks that try and chop up the ground plane. And that's gonna be one of the topics in the next video. All right, everybody, thanks for watching. I hope you enjoy some of these mixed signal design tips. We're gonna have more in the next video. They all relate to return current path tracking and ground planes in your mixed signal PCB. Don't forget to hack that YouTube algorithm for us. Hit the like button, hit the subscribe button, click on the links in the description, leave some comments, and don't forget to call your fabricator.